For almost 100 years, people the world over have enjoyed L. Frank Baum's enchanting stories, books, plays, and movies about the Land of Oz. Now, Kenneth Feld has created a whole new show for Oz fans everywhere, The Wizard of Oz on Ice.
I didn't want to do the 1939 Wizard of Oz movie. I wanted to do a new production.
When I was hired to do the job, I actually only ended up watching the film once. I didn't want to find myself trying to do a carbon copy when I got to the ice.
The interesting thing about seeing Dorothy played on the ice is that she, in fact, has a new creative expression. It's the thing that only skating does, and that is gliding and flying through the air.
The Wizard of Oz was a great movie musical, but it lends itself more to ice because you can get more movement. And the entire story of The Wizard of Oz is a journey. So we have the ability, through the medium of ice, to take you on this journey in a fast-paced, exciting way down that yellow brick road.
Once we decided to move it onto the ice, we had to preserve at all costs the glorification of just being a human being.
I have so got brains.
Well, why don't you use them? When you come home, don't go by Miss Gulch's place. Then Toto won't get no trouble, see?
Anyhow, she ain't nothing to be afraid of. Have a little courage, that's all.
I'm not afraid of her.
Each of the characters were characteristics that we have at different times in our lives. And so you have a cowardly lion, someone who's a coward. You have a scarecrow who isn't the top intellect. And you have a tin man who's not very active physically. These people team together and become much more than any of them as individuals. They conquer their shortcomings because they're working together.
I'd be brave as a blizzard.
I'd be gentle as a lizard.
I'd be clever as a gizzard.
If the wizard is a wizard, who will serve?
Then I'm sure to get a brain,
a heart,
a home,
the knife.
We remember these wonderful pieces, but most of all, we remember what these characters represent. That's the strength of the story, it's the strength of The Wizard of Oz, and it's the strength of this show.
Because.
One of the problems that we faced with this was, do we try to recreate Judy Garland and the entire original cast, which is a classic, but the more I found out about the film and its quality of honesty and genuineness, the less I wanted to do an imitation.
Jerry Billick, who directed the show, who adapted the music and the storyline, came up with the idea. He said, you know, we've got to make this a little different. Why don't we get Bobby McFerrin to do all the voices?
It occurred to me that with all these actors that we might have to deal with, why not have one person play everything?
Yeah.
One, two, hit me.
If I were king of the forest.
Now let me do that again. One, two.
If I were a king of the forest,
not queen, not duke, not prince.
When we got into the studio, the problem was, how would he maintain this consistency of characters?
There were some lines for each of the characters that I always go back to get back into the character, like with the scarecrow.
They took my legs and they threw it over there! Then they took my chest and they threw it over there!
With the Tin Man, he would always say,
no heart.
No heart?
No heart.
Oh.
And then for the lion, you put him up, put him up.
Put him up, put him up. I'll fight you with one part time behind my back.
Not only does he do the voices, he does Toto. And he does about 90% of the sound effects that you hear in the show as well.
Look, it's Toto. Where did he come from?
Don't you see? He's come to take us to Dorothy.
I'll get you, my pretty.
And your little dog, too. Ouch.
What do you think you're doing?
I am Oz, the great and powerful. Who are you?
Then Lorne Wilkerson was Bobby McFerrin's idea, so we were able to put the two of them together.
To see the wizard, the wonderful Wizard of Oz. We hear he is the wizard of a wiz, if ever a wiz there was. If ever, oh ever, a wiz there was, the Wizard of Oz is one.
Because. Come on!
Because of the wonderful things he does. We're off to see the wizard, the wonderful Wizard of Oz!
Jerry Billick's a very interesting director because he's more than the director. He has his fingers in more pies than that. He's a musician. And the music of this piece is so important, and he knows so much about it, and he knows how the music flows and how the music works.
The key thing in the entire production would be how Over the Rainbow was sung, because the audience identified it so much with Judy Garland, with the original picture.
Every time I hear that song, and when I hear it with Lorne Wilkerson singing it in this show, and I see Jerry Campbell skating to it, I still get chills.
Score was written in 1938-39, so I wanted to somehow combine a symphonic sound of the full orchestra with violins and harp with a contemporary rhythm section and not lose also the beautiful quality, the simple quality of the melodies and harmony. So that was my tightrope act.
And there's a piece of music that was cut from the original movie for a lot of different reasons, and we researched that, and they came up with the idea to use the jitterbug.
Who's that? Who's that?
Who's that hiding in the treetop? It's that rascal, the jitterbug. Should you catch him buzzing round you, keep away from the jitterbug. Oh, the bats and the bees and the breeze and the trees have a terrible, horrible buzz. But the bats and the bees and the breeze and the trees couldn't do what the jitterbug does. So be careful of that.
I've worked with Kenneth Feld for many years, and because he sensed that there was something different in this material, he also sensed that he needed a new and different production team.
One skater that since I saw him in the 1980 Olympics that's always stood out in my mind was Robin Cousins.
I would like to think that a lot of the skating, in fact, helps the story along. And I think the dialogue, the skating, and the music go hand in hand very well.
five, six, seven, and...
You know, teaching new moves and new maneuvers and things, you need to be able to sort of put it in a format that they will understand, that they can see it in color in their brain before they're trying it.
Robin ultimately has done is to take the human qualities of the film and perfectly translate them onto the ice.
He's got so much music, so much choreography in his head.
I then made a call to Frank Krenz, and I thought he would be the perfect costume designer for this show.
I took on this project because it was an opportunity for pure design, and you don't get those pure opportunities very often. We could invent something. We began the process of designing it by going back to some original sources, to the books that the movie was based on, and looked at the original illustrations for that. Designing the costumes for Munchkinland was the biggest challenge. It scared me the most and ended up being the most fun because we don't have little people with us. Kenneth Feld said, change the shape of them.
The Munchkinland scene has to put a smile on everybody's face. It is the happiest scene I've ever seen in a show in my life.
We represent the Lollipop Guild, the Lollipop Guild, the Lollipop Guild. And in the name of the Lollipop Guild, we wish to welcome you to Munchkinland.
Frank came up with colors and shapes and designs that are humorous. The skaters, when they put them on the first time, were literally laughing. And the things that Robin and I wanted them to do as Munchkins, the costumes were making them do.
Costumes are definitely a character, particularly in an ice show. They're not only a character, they're scenery.
Ouch!
What do you think you're doing?
Well, I was hungry and... did you just
she
say...
She was hungry, but how would you like to have someone come along and pick something off of you?
Oh, dear. I keep forgetting I'm not in Kansas.
I'll show you how to get apples.
Come along, Dorothy. You don't want any of those apples.
Are you hinting my apples aren't what they ought to be?
Oh, no. It's just that she doesn't like little green worms.
Oh, yeah?
We'll give you little green worms, you.
Watch this.
You can't do that to me. I'll show you.
You can't do that.
You can't do that.
You can't do that.
You can't do that.
It's a man made out of tin.
What?
The Tin Man costume has lots of different elements to it, made by all sorts of artisans. There's a hand-painted unitard on the inside, all sorts of latex and foam applications on the outside, and prosthetics on his face, as well as makeup, and he still has to be able to skate.
The next situation was to get a set design that took us into the year 2000 with The Wizard of Oz.
Step forward, Tin Man.
Whoa, it's me.
You dare to come to me for a heart, do you? You clinking, clanking, clattering collection of collisionist junk.
Yes, sir, Your Honor. You see, a while back, we were walking down the yellow brick road.
Quiet! And you, Scarecrow, have the effrontery to ask for a brain, you billowing bale of bovine fodder?
Yes, Your Honor. I mean, Your Excellency. I mean, Your Wizardry.
Enough! And you, lion.
So I went to Mark Fisher, who did the Rolling Stones, Voodoo Lounge Tour, and REM, and Pink Floyd, and a lot of these rock and roll groups, and he had never done a show anything like this.
Kenneth wanted it to be different, but he had a very clear idea of what different meant. He wanted it to be more three-dimensional, meaning something which takes the show more out onto the ice.
Look over there!
Look at one!
It's Dorothy, come on! Wait. Quiet. There are guards everywhere. Dorothy!
Huh? What?
Dorothy, it's us.
Oh, Toto! Toto!
Did they hurt you?
Oh, Lion, darling, I knew you'd come.
Dorothy!
I knew you would.
Hurry, we've got no time to lose.
Little party is just beginning.
It's one thing to make a great fancy set and put it on Broadway for 2-3 years, but it's another thing to make a set that is assembled for 4 days and in a very specific amount of time has to open on the next Tuesday for a whole other audience in a whole other city. And he was able to do that.
This is a show that I could really enjoy doing because it's combining fantasy with, particularly in the Emerald City, this very architectural idea. And so the opportunity of designing a kind of little fantasy city, the Emerald City, was actually a real attraction.
Good people of Oz, I'm about to embark upon a hazardous journey into the outer stratosphere, and I hereby declare that until that time that I return...
Toto, come back! Oh, don't go without me!
Help! The balloon
ruined my exit!
No, come back!
I don't know how it works!
I then called Leroy Bennett to do the lighting. And Roy Bennett has done MTV awards for many years. He's done also the major rock acts around the world. And he's really a rock and roll lighting designer and a scenic designer as well.
Lighting the ice is a perfect canvas to paint. The lights themselves have their own personality as far as projecting a mood or an emotion.
Horse of a different color you've heard about.
Ha ha ha, ho ho ho, and a couple of tra-la-las. That's how we lost the day away in the radio land of Oz.
The other thing is, we have a tornado. We've got to have a house flying.
The tornado is a very unique thing to light. We have a scan light, which gives you a very swirling motion, and eventually it moves off of the ice into the audience's face to give them the feeling that they're not only watching the tornado, they are in the tornado.
So we have the latest technology and all kinds of lighting equipment and special effects to bring The Wizard of Oz to date.
This particular production is about ordinary human beings trying to overcome extraordinary obstacles.
I had to learn here a backflip, but luckily enough, Robin Cousins, who has one of the best in the world, taught me, so that made life a lot easier.
The hardest part is making sure that all the characters blend together naturally. You basically can't go lower than 100%, and so I think that makes for a fantastic show.
I have never seen a group of skaters more dedicated to elevating a production in my life than what I see here on this show.
We're trying to take these characters and have them interact with the audience so that the audience is actually walking down the yellow brick road with us.
Whatever their role is, they are proud of it.
I never thought that I would be involved in playing Dorothy. In between all my skating time, I work with Toto. It's probably one of my harder jobs is to have a dog for a partner, but one of my most fun jobs.
When you get down to it, we can have great lighting and we have wonderful scenery and all the costumes. It is the heart and soul of the performers that make any show.
Oh, will you help me? Can you help me?
You don't need to be helped any longer. You've always had the power to go back to Kansas.
The journey that Dorothy and her friends take to Oz, through Oz, and back to Kansas is a journey of life.
What have you learned, Dorothy?
Well, I think it's that if I ever go looking for my heart's desire again, I won't look any further than my own backyard.
It's all the things that we encounter. If you're a young child, you go to school that first day, maybe you meet the bully on the playground. You don't know how to face it. You don't have the courage. Maybe you don't do so well on a test. All of these things are what happens with all of us, whether we're a little child or whether we're that big child.
Now those magic slippers will take you home in 2 seconds.
Oh, Toto 2?
Toto 2.
Oh dear, that's too wonderful to be true. Oh, it's going to be so hard to say goodbye. Oh, Tin Man, don't cry. You'll rust so dreadfully. Here.
Now I know I've got a heart, because it's breaking.
Found it if it hadn't have been for you.
I think I'll miss you most of all. Goodbye, Toto. I'm ready now.
Then close your eyes and tap your heels together 3 times.
The story is not only about Dorothy's discovering her true needs, but also about general hope.
And think to yourself, there's no place like home. There's no place like home.
And said in such a way that children can discover that on their own without being told. And it's also, I think, nice for adults to be reminded every now and again.
The thing about audiences going to a live show is that it's like a tribal experience where you enjoy something with a lot of other people. You get really excited.
It's the original Greek theatrical experience. It's how theater came to be, a community sharing emotions that they all have in common. And I think that's what Kenneth, in every one of his shows, tries to create, that moment, that commonality with everyone that's there. And he's pretty good at it, I think.
Speechless.